Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. Keep these words that I'm commanding you today in your heart. Recite them to your children. Talk about them when you are at home and when you are away, when you lie down and when you rise. Bind them as a sign on your hand. Fix them as an emblem on your forehead. And write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. This is the word of the Lord for the people of God. All honor, glory, and praises due to God. You may be seated in God's presence. My brothers and sisters, as I told you on last Sunday, Beloved Community Church, after we gathered for worship and had a little bite to eat, we went to the movies together to watch the movie Black Panther. Black Panther has become a cultural phenomenon in the movie theaters. It is the first movie of its kind to be made with such a big budget, a movie that was not only written and directed by black people, but has an almost entirely black starting and supporting cast, costume designers. All throughout the movie not only visualizes, but celebrates blackness in its many forms and shapes and beauty. And this movie has become an important fixture. And there's also great truth in it that helps us to understand what God may be saying and doing. And in this movie, the movie begins with an origin story. You hear the voice of a child asking to be told a story. And the voice of the father who says, "What story do you want me to tell you?" And the child says, "Tell me the story of home." And in the few minutes, we hear the origin story of this nation called Wakanda, the story of five tribes who settle on this land that has been enriched by this metal called vibranium. And the tribes do what most people do. They fight and argue over the land until a divine force brings them together. And they shed their tribal identities, or at least make their tribal identities secondary to their national identity. They become one people with one name, and that name is Wakanda. And they remember and celebrate that with the proclamation, "Wakanda forever." Now, I don't know if it was done intentionally or not, but that origin story of the people of Wakanda mirrors the origin story of the people in the Bible, that especially in these five books that are the books of Torah or instruction, that these tell the story of a people who have been liberated from oppression in Egypt, but not just in their liberation, but also how they are brought together to build a nation and a national identity. The historical evidence from this period reaffirms what is suggested in the biblical text, and that is that this journey from liberation to national identity was not necessarily a smooth journey. In other words, they did not emerge out of Egypt with an understanding of themselves as one people. That understanding came together over time and through great challenges and difficulty. That they realized they had a common goal, first of liberation and then of stability and security. But how they got there was through challenges, through fights, arguments that broke out. if you remember with me, brothers and sisters, there was a period of time in their history where Moses, the leader, the liberator, the one that was able to unite them together under a common purpose, Moses goes away to talk to God for an extended period of time. He climbs up to the mountain, a mountain that not everybody could climb because God's presence was said to be felt there in such a heavy way that if you climbed the mountain without a direct invitation from God, you would risk your very life. Moses is invited up to the mountain and he begins to talk to God, but in being in the mountain, Moses is away from the people. The people can't see him. He's not there for them to experience his presence and his leadership. And so what happens in the absence of Moses is fights begin to emerge, squabbles break out, people begin to try to seize power for themselves. They begin to argue with one another. And so because of the fighting and squabbling, they say, we need to figure out something. God and Moses are spending too long in this mountain. And so we need to find a new leader. But not only do they find a new leader, but they find a new God. Now, I want you to remember that the God that they had been following was the one that brought them out of Egypt and had delivered them from their oppression into the wilderness and had sustained them all this time. But in this midst of panic, in the midst of this uncertainty, they decide we need to choose a new God to lead us. And so they begin to do what they had learned to do in Egypt. They began to do what they learned to do in their oppression and in their slavery. They took the gold that they had, they melted it down, they built a statue, and then they said, this is our new God. And they worshiped the statue that they created. They voted Aaron to be the new president of the land. And then they said, Aaron, take us back to Egypt so that we can go back, because at least in Egypt we had food. At least in Egypt we ate. There was some security there in Egypt. They had just that quickly forgotten everything they had been delivered from and were eager to go back. My brothers and sisters, this was part of the uncertainty that happened on their way to finding and establishing their own national identity. This text, the text that we are in right now, it emerges after they have been traveling for 40 years in the wilderness, trying to, as we say, they had gotten out of Egypt, but they had not gotten Egypt out of them. So it's 40 years later, they are now come to the place where they have begun to establish enough of a national identity that they can begin to fulfill the promises that God made to their parents and grandparents in establishing and embarking on their first steps as a unified nation. So Moses begins to embark upon the sermon in Deuteronomy to tell them, to lead them, and help them understand what God was doing in their midst. And he begins the sermon with this proclamation, hear this, O Israel, the Lord our God is one God. The Lord is one. And you need to love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And I was a little bit confused as to why it would begin by saying that the Lord our God is one. Why was there confusion about this? Were they having some misunderstandings about the Trinity and what the Trinity means? Did they think they were worshiping three gods instead of one? But then I realized that they wouldn't have talked about or understood the concept of Trinity at this time. That's not something they would have known or understood. So that could have been it. Why would they need to say the Lord our God is one? What was the confusion that meant that this needed to, what was the question that they needed to answer by the statement, the Lord our God is one? And I realized, my brothers and sisters, the confusion was not about the nature of God. They were not concerned or confused about the number or multiplicity of God. That the reason they were saying the Lord our God is one God didn't have anything to do with God, but it had everything to do with them. My brothers and sisters, what I'm trying to say is that the division was not in God, the division was in the people. the proclamation that our God is one God was not meant to solve a crisis about who God was, but was meant to help paint a picture of who they were called to be. They were the ones that were divided. They were the ones that were scattered. They were the ones who were at risk for the tribalism of the people to reemerge and separate and divide the work that God was trying to do. And so what Moses wanted to remind them is we are all here together worshiping the same God. And because we are all worshiping one God, then we ought to be united in the work that we do. My brothers and sisters, unity is a hard notion to figure out. It is hard for us to figure out how to work together and live together. It's easy to talk about unity, but it's hard to do. If you don't believe me, just ask somebody who's been married for any period of time. And I'm sure they will tell, I don't know this by personal experience, but I'm sure they will tell you that it was much easier to stand and take the vow to love one another in sickness and in health, for better or for worse, for richer or for poor, than it was to live those pledges, to live those promises, to live those vows. It's easier to say you're going to do a thing, but when better and worse times really come, when richer or poorer times really come, when sickness and in health really comes, it's not as easy to live it as it is to say and to talk about it. Unity is a challenge, my brothers and sisters. That's why so many churches divide. That's why so many of our people split and separate out. Because it is easy to talk about, to sing about, to pray about. It's easy to proclaim the unity that we have in God, but it's hard to live this thing out. Sometimes we have arguments, we have fights over who ought to be leading, over what direction we ought to be going, what this program ought to look like, what that program ought to look like. And those fights, while seemingly small, my brothers and sisters, have real emotional attachment to them. And sometimes we forget the bigger mission, we forget the bigger work, and we get so lost in our emotions and attachment to the details that we have no choice but to split. The church that Martin Luther King first pastored in Alabama was a split of another church down the street. And they split because they had a disagreement over which way the stairs ought to go when they left the church. One group said the stairs ought to face Redding Road, and another group said no, the stairs ought to face Fred Shuttlesworth Circle. And they had a disagreement over which direction the stairs ought to face. And because of that disagreement, some people, they took their Bibles and their hymnals and went down the street and built their own church. This is the history, the reason we have multiple conventions, the reason we have a National Baptist Convention USA Incorporated in the National Baptist Convention of America had to do with who was going to publish the books for Sunday school. It was not about a disagreement about who God is, or was not about doctrinal disagreement. This was not about prayer or Bible study. It wasn't about people being unfaithful to God. This was about who was going to publish those books for Sunday school. And because of that argument, they couldn't figure out how to settle it, so they split into two convictions. That split has lasted over 150 years over who publishes the Sunday school books. Brothers and sisters, we are divided sometimes over the simplest things, and we forget of the unity we have in God. Of the unity that we have in Christ. And my brothers and sisters, it wouldn't be so bad. I mean, honestly, the number of churches, the fact that we have in Avondale, in the neighborhood that we are currently worshiping in right now, the fact that in this neighborhood, on this day, there are at least 53 churches that are worshiping in 52 buildings in Avondale right now, would not be such a bad thing our brothers and sisters. There's more opportunities for people to engage and encounter God and experience the love and presence of Jesus Christ. It would not be such a bad thing if we could figure out in our separate spaces how to work together. The opportunity, the missed opportunity, my brothers and sisters, is that the needs of our community are so great.
Oh, yeah.
But our unity, our cooperation is so small. My brothers and sisters, if you ever want to be reminded of the genius of Reverend Jesse Jackson, just look up his 1984 speech in Philadelphia as he's running for president of the United States. And he talks about the 1980 election of Ronald Reagan. And the point he's making is that Ronald Reagan won, not because Ronald Reagan was such a great politician, not because he's such a brilliant political strategist, but because he was so charismatic or any of the other things that people were saying about him, that Ronald Reagan won the presidency in 1980 because we couldn't figure out how to work together. Ronald Reagan won because of two things. He said he won because of the margin of our despair. In other words, because of the number of people who did not vote, who could have voted, who were eligible to vote, but instead sat home because they did not believe their vote counted. We lost because of the margin of our despair and because of the fracture of our coalition. Because we could not figure out how to work together, to be together, to stand together, and fight together, that because of that, Ronald Reagan won and instituted practices and policies that went against black people and Hispanic people and poor people, that Ronald Reagan created policies that made America financially less stable than it should have been, began to retract all the gains of the civil rights movement because of the margin of our despair and the fraction of our coalition. So when we look and we see that that poverty in Avondale is greater than it is, not only in other neighborhoods in the city, but in many third world countries, when we look and see that life expectancy in Avondale is 20 years less than life expectancy right across the imaginary line of North Avondale, when we see that the number of children who die, the infant mortality rate of Avondale is the third worst in the United States, with a state-of-the-art children's hospital right next door. When we see what's happening, my brothers and sisters, then the division that we have in our churches can't be looked at as neutral. The reason these conditions continue is because of the margin of our despair and the fracture of our coalition. What would it look like if we were able to combine some of the resources of all of these churches? These 52 churches in Avondale were to be able to come together and just to donate a portion of their goods and resources, a portion of their talent and treasure, a portion of their brain power and heart power and energy power to addressing the problems that are happening right here in the neighborhood. Avondale could be Wakanda. We could create our own center of power right here if we were able to come together and remember that we all serve the same God. And that all the people in these streets, everybody, Pookie, Ray Ray, and all of them, they are all God's people.
Amen.
But we are defeated by the margin of our despair and the fracture of our coalition. Moses knew this and he realized this. So he begins the sermon by reminding them, God is one God. God is calling us to stand, to live, and to work together. My brothers and sisters, this nation building work, it doesn't happen overnight. It takes practice. So what is it in this text that helps us to see, to understand how we do this nation-building work? There are three things I believe the text teaches us of how we do this nation-building work. The first thing Moses says in this is that you have to take time to talk to your children about this. The work of nation-building, the work of reaching out and addressing the needs of God's people is not something that happens in a generation. It's not something that happens in one lifetime, that the work has has to go on perpetually. I want you to know that right now, somewhere in some room, or probably across many rooms right now because of our ability to digitally communicate, there are people who are plotting what is going to happen in this city 20, 25, 30, 40, 50 years down the line. And so while many of us are in a space where we are praying, give us this day our daily bread, there's somebody that has a design for what your life is going to look like 20 years down the line. My brothers and sisters, what I'm simply trying to say is that this work is not something that happens and that ends. It's not a victory or a goal or a finish line that we can cross and say that we've done, we finished with that, we are done. This work takes, we have to engage in this as a constant and continuous struggle. And so because of that, we have to teach our children. It's the importance of having things like Black History Month, where we take time to point to what God has done in our history. And it's the importance of having, taking time as a part of worship to share with our children about the hills that we've crossed, the valleys that we have gone through. It's important that we take time to do this. Moses says to the people, tell your children this when they wake up and when they go to bed, when they go out of town and when they're playing out in the yard. Always make sure that you are taking time to share with your children the history of what God has done. When they cross the Jordan River, Moses tells them to put stones on one side of the Jordan and keep the stones there so that when people ask, Mama, Daddy, why are these stones here by the river? You can remind them, you can tell them about what God has done in this place, my brothers and sisters. Jesus himself, he was with the disciples. He was engaged in a board meeting with the disciples. A group of children came and wanted to talk to Jesus. And the disciples said, get out of here, children. We're in a board meeting. Don't you see? We're having a deacon's meeting. The trustees are meeting right now. We don't have time for children in this. But Jesus said, no, suffer the children to come unto me and forbid them not. Such is the kingdom of heaven. We've got to take time to talk to, reach out to incorporate our children in everything we do. I can tell you myself, my brothers and sisters, that part of the reason that I'm standing here right now, part of the reason that I'm preaching and pastoring right now, part of the reason is because when I was a child, somebody made it important to include me in what was going on. I went to a church where they did not allow children to celebrate communion, and so I would have to sit there by myself while everybody else was eating crackers and drinking grape juice. I didn't know what it meant. All I know is that everybody else had snacks except for me, and I didn't understand what was going on. So my mother made it a point to take some graham crackers and pour a little bit of juice in a bottle, and so when everybody else was eating their communion, I had my own communion. I didn't know what it meant, but I knew I was included in what was going on. There was a deacon, his name was James Ellington. Deacon Ellington would make it a point every Sunday he would come and find me and shake my hand. And we had a special handshake that we did, kind of like the handshake they had in Black Panther. We did it first. We had our own special handshake, Deacon Ellington. And me, and he would always say, good morning, handsome. It's so good to see you. And so I would find my way to Deacon Ellington because I wanted to have a handshake with him and for him to call me handsome. I wanted to experience that. I was welcomed in the house of God. So we've got to make sure, my brothers and sisters, that our churches are placed where our children are included and a part of, where we celebrate them, where they feel like this is their home too. Teach your children, Moses says. Teach them the lessons. It's why also, my brothers and sisters, it's important. It's why we do things like take our children to go see Black Panther. Because we can't act like what's happening in the world outside of the church doesn't impact our children who are in the church.
Amen, amen.
And so whether or not we want to engage it, they're going to experience it one way or another. And so we might as well take the opportunities to go to a movie together, to sit together, and then to talk about what the movie means and how it applies to their lives, to help give them the tools to be able to look through and critically dissect and understand the messages for their lives, every once in a while, we ought to do something that just isn't Bible study. It's all right to sit with your children and listen to the Beyonce track, listen to what Beyonce is saying with your children. I know you might not understand it the first time, but just listen to it a couple of times. You'll catch up to it. Your children are listening to it anyway. They're hearing this at school. People are singing these lyrics all around them. And so we might as well engage this with them to help them make sense of what's happening in the world around them. Moses said, take time to teach your children. The second thing he says, not only should you teach your children, but you also ought to remember for yourself. He says, write it on your forehead, bind it to your arm. You ought to have personal reminders so that you can remember what God has done. I think what Moses understood, my brothers and sisters, that psychologists teach us now is that it's easier to remember the bad things that happened than the good things that happened. Psychologists will tell you that for every bad thing that happens, you need 5 memories of good things to happen just to get back to neutral. My brothers and sisters, it's so much easier to remember the bad things. You can be having a good day. Wake up this morning feeling great. The sun is shining, birds are singing your name. Everything seems wonderful. You go to grab that cup of coffee or tea or water or orange juice or whatever it is you drink first thing in the morning and spill it on yourself, and you forgot all about the good things that happened up until that point. One bad thing can impact our mind, my brothers and sisters, so that we forget about the good things. I think that's why in the wilderness, despite all that God had done, they decided to vote God out of office and vote Moses out of office. That's why, because in that moment, in the crisis they felt in that current situation, they could not remember everything that God had done in the past, which is why we ought to give ourselves reminders. Moses said, write it down on your forehead and on your arm so that every time you begin to forget what God has done, you have a reminder. You need to remember these things, my brothers and sisters. And just in case somebody came to the house today and forgot how good God is, can I remind you of at least 5 things God has done for you? Did God wake you up this morning? When you woke up, were you in your right mind? Were you able to get to the church house? Did somebody give you a hug or a handshake or smile at you or wave at you, say it's good to see you? Is there somebody in your life that loves you, that cares about you? Is there food on the table in your refrigerator? Do you have electricity or running water? That's at least 7 or 8 right there, things that God has done for you. So if nothing else in your life is going right, you ought to be able to stand up and run around and give God praise just for those things. And we haven't even begun to scratch the surface yet, because I didn't ask you if God saved your soul. I didn't ask you if he loved you before you loved yourself. I didn't ask you if God claimed you as God's own. Remember the good things that God has done. Have a testimony, my brothers and sisters. Remember, keep a written record. Write in a diary, in a journal. Post it on a post-it note. Put it up in your house. Put it in your car. Keep something in your wallet. Have a reminder of the good things that God has done. Last but not least, what Moses says to the people is not only do you need a personal reminder, but you need a corporate reminder too. And that's why he said, put it out on your door so that people walk by your house, they see it on the door. Put it on the city gate so that when strangers and people walk in and out of the city, they can see what God has done. That's why we come to church on Sunday, my brothers and sisters. That's why we gather together. I know God is everywhere, and I know you can experience God in your house, in your bed, by yourself, under the covers. I know you can experience God there the same way you can here. God is the same, and God is everywhere. You don't have to come to church to find God, but we come together as a corporate testimony, my brothers and sisters. We come together so that we can remember together about the goodness of God, and we come together so that we can share a testimony so that others around us can see about what God is doing in our midst. We come together because there are people who live our children. If we can remember God's goodness in our lives, and if we can commit ourselves to corporate testimony, then we can begin to build the nation that God desires for us to be. I know we might not be able to change all the forces around us, but it's all right. Because the Bible reminds me, greater is the one that is in us than the one that is in the world. I know it's not going to change. It's not going to get Donald Trump out of office right now, but it's okay. Because the God I serve helped little David to beat Goliath. And if little David can beat Goliath, then all of these people together can stop Donald Trump. I'm not worried about that, my brothers and sisters, because I believe that the God we serve, the God is one God. God can do anything but fail. We have a practice at Beloved Community Church that we want to share with you. We call it response to the word.